communities I've ever worked with, but it is also one that is incredibly engaged in making our neighborhoods safer and stronger and healthier for everybody. And this festival, now coming back to the second annual Barrio Festival, is about bringing all of our diverse communities here together. Here in this district, I represent the poorest residents and the wealthiest residents of San Francisco. We have so much going on, and we need to do a lot more work to make sure we are taking care of our seniors, our young people, our families, but also working to make San Francisco more affordable. I love our community activists and leaders here. April's here. Many of you know April Benrafian Ng, who is part of my legislative team. She's here with her children. And we do want to bring up a number of our community leaders that made this festival possible, but beyond the festival, do so much on behalf of this community to increase childcare services, improve our only South of Market K-8 school, Bessie Carmichael, working to strengthen Jean Friend Rec Center and Victoria Manolo Drake Park, and also working to fight evictions and increase affordable housing here in the city. And that is the community that I come from and that I'm proud to be here with. So one of the perks of my job is that I get to give out little pieces of paper to recognize people for their tremendous leadership and advocacy. So I want to bring up April. Many of you know my all mothers team. I have all mothers of color on my legislative team. They are running things at City Hall. They are writing policies and laws and advocating for all of our communities. So please give up for April Benrafian Ng. All right. So my job is to call the wonderful leaders and organizers here on the stage who help make this happen. First of all, thank you all for coming. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Our next song is called Summertime. Can I call Kuya PJ up and Kuya Ray?
And it's open. It's going to be open for us to teach people in the community. If you're interested, just ask us. We're going to take down your name. There's an application for it. The class won't cost anything, so we do a screening. And essentially, we're going to cover various aspects of Filipino martial arts today. Start with the stick, the antoks. And it's a very, personally, I just want to say it's a very important part of who I am. It helped me find a real strong cultural identity in terms of a real true Filipino identity and in relation to the diaspora. So first is, you've heard it referred to as three different things, Kali, Arnis, and Eskrima. These are essentially the stick and the weapon arts. And Arnis is really rooted in stick, and it's performed, it has the ability to have different retractions to it and reflecting strikes. So it has its own thing, everybody's familiar with this. But the art took a turn in terms of the Spanish occupation, and also there's a lot of, with all the trade that came through, people talk about specific weapons from a region. We just assume everybody fought with everything they can get their hands on that was traded through. So with the Spanish, there came the espada y daga, the tradition that's still around that a lot of people hear about today. And with that, I may, this. With the espada y daga, the movements are the knife and dagger. They're very classical, and they're done in length.
So we're just going to do a little exchange. It's a little tit for tat here, using sword and dagger.
So it has a very fluid thing to it. When it comes to the stick, it's more of an impact instrument. And with the sword and dagger, the blades also change. That's classical, but there is also a very more of a style that's rooted in the culture itself, more of an agricultural kind of style. And it's built on more of the bolo. So it's longer, heavier strikes. And he's kind of in a resting pose. This is the average guy. This is the guy who lives with his bolo. You don't really want to mess with him. I don't know. I just want to feed him. He's going to feed him a little bit, and Nino can kind of. This is Nino. He's going to go ahead and respond. So the bolo is a lot more of a classical. It's a full body power kind of a stroke and response, and the expression is completely different. It's not that upright classical style. All right, thanks guys. Also within the agricultural. In a sense, this is a fishing tool, or a clean the fish tool, I should say, for fishing. There's a whole other expression that comes with a shorter blade also that has to do with definitely not that proper upright posture that we were talking about.
Don't have a leg.
So if he was to be attacked with a longer weapon, his response would be different than how I would be attacking with this.
This one's live? Okay. Good thing, good reminder.
It has a directness to it, and in terms of it having a current value, the martial culture in the Philippines switched to guns clearly after World War II, but in terms of its relevant value today, it's one of the only martial arts in which people still use it every day or still used in this world today for their survival. And in relation to how it's relevant here in the South of Market, if you look at the statistics, the gunshots compared to assaults with deadly weapons and stabbings that happen in the city, those are in the hundreds. And those are pretty random. Everybody's like, well, I try to avoid conflict, but it's more about predators, what we need to protect ourselves from. People who don't size things up and don't converse, they just see a target and they go for it and they take what they want. So that's a little more of the concern that we want to deal with. It's not about attacking other people. And I've been going on. Let me get this.
So historically, in Philippine martial culture, things have gotten shorter over time because we originally used to fight with spears and shields. Nowadays, a lot of that tradition has been lost because we started switching to swords, part of it being the Spanish influence. And A lot of things that you see nowadays with Filipino martial arts has to do with shorter and shorter blades. You see it with military, police, and security forces, and even a lot of these arts are a product of different foreign influences. So like balisong that we currently associate with being traditionally Filipino, the records of it being from France or other places in Europe. But it's something that we do, like we take influences and make it our own. So that's the same thing with jeepneys. We take old jeeps and we make it something intrinsically Filipino. So,
and we'll do a little balisong demo.
It's a fork, so I'll probably use this for...
Yeah, there's a fork on the end of this one in particular. Just for eating.
Legality.
Yeah.
You can't carry normal balisongs around nowadays.
I just want to see what you go say.
So the weapon movement changes as it gets shorter. There's something to be said for the sword, and what it is essentially the weapon in your hand is an extension of your will. And the longer the weapon is your ability to control the environment around you and the space around you for you to own it and pick your angles. But the shorter the weapon, the more random, the more anybody can just whip it around and hurt somebody. So the one of the benefits of Filipino martial arts training in terms of the blade is that you really get to clean up your angles and get an understanding as to where you can really get hurt. Now, this is a flow drill. This isn't how somebody would necessarily deal with attacks that are brutal. This is just to understand the angles and the lines. To secure it, okay, let's try something else. See, there's a nice little disarm that he did with his elbow. It's cute. But if somebody was attacking more aggressively, his true answer would be different. So clearly, you know, it's different when just swinging a weapon around when somebody kind of puts their weight behind it and comes at you. And so when you see people being all pretty with a knife, there's more of a reality about training the force and the intent of a person and having to deal with that. And we like to train that part true. What else? Is that it? So, a lot of times when you think about Filipino martial arts, you think about stick. It's taught in PE courses in the Philippines. It's a national sport, a national art. Traditionally, a lot of the sticks that were used for fighting were really heavy. It's like straight up cudgel. Over time, they became lighter. Part of that was, in terms of practicing, there's not much back and forth with a heavy stick. One hit, boom. Nobody can play anymore.
How can you keep them from taking that stick from you and using it on you? How do you keep them from taking that stick?
So a question from the audience was, how do you learn how to hold on to your stick? It's because weapon retention is actually really important, too. Yeah, it's just like a police officer, if you have a gun on your hip.
Oh, I'm up here.
Yeah, it's no good if you can't keep it and protect. So
to answer your question, we'll do an exchange here, and essentially the game will be to secure the other person's stick. Now, if we were doing a full out, we'd be kind of hitting each other a little bit too. We're going to skip that part, but you'll kind of see, you know, there's different ranges. There's largo, where we can't be in reach of each other. There's people who say the medio begins when we can hit each other's hands. And then there's corto, which moves in closer, and it gets closer and closer. And yeah, you got to be able to handle all three zones. So an example of what you were asking about, what do you do when the other person has stick? Because even when you grab it, if you grab it too high, you see people come running at you like that. The moment I come up and he secures this, I'm wrestling with this, and he's beating me up with the other one.
Yeah.
That's what's going on. So you can't. You have to kind of, you know, protect yourself. So if I need to use this to pop him, bang, 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 I got space, but don't give him too much. So we'll do this little drill called Posada, and you'll see what happens.
And part and parcel of training, like some of the fundamental stuff for training Filipino martial arts, is to swim in the danger. So like if there's areas where you're uncomfortable or you don't know what's happening, is expose yourself to them, get familiar.
So don't be afraid to get whacked and just take it out.
Yeah, because life is going to whap you. Sometimes you just need to roll with the punches. Part of it is, to repeat the question is, how do you deal with staying calm and maintaining your breath?
Thank you.
A lot of it is just exposure to this over time, because the less foreign it is, the more familiar you are with something that feels dangerous. Initially, then it's just something that happens. So, and also, training and conditioning, there are exercises that we do to help you build up your breath.
But your defense needs to be relative to you. You know, if you're not meant to sit there and wrestle with a big dude, then it needs to be specific to what attack you can get in, what it is you can separate to get the space and get the safety. And at the end of the day, none of us want to sit here and get into exchanges with knives or anything like that, because the rule is two knives in a knife fight, two people get cut. So we're not into that. We're just trying to find our way out and go home and be safe.
Thank you. Can you come to a lot of women's
centers? We're interested in doing some training, self-defense, and we also would like to do a Filipino martial arts clinic.
Yeah, and a lot of this training is personalized. So how I move, how I can do stuff, it's going to differ from how I teach my nieces, how I teach my sister, you know, my cousins, older, younger. All those considerations should take place. So if you have any people that you're interested in learning martial arts, or if we need some self-defense, you can also give us your contact info for research. And you had a question? What was that? Okay. There's a Filipino martial arts master, Kalito, I believe his name is Bonjok. He actually is missing a leg, so he specializes in, like, grappling stuff while seated. So part of it is, like, there are arts and approaches out there where you can actually – you have to take all those considerations into mind. So you have to do what's good for you. Find the people who can help you grow. All right. Where are the SoMa Filipino Martial Arts Club? Thank you.
Yeah, if you're interested, please get in contact with us afterwards. And, yeah. Next up will be Dirty Boots, I believe. They'll be properly introduced.
Ooh, big cops are never gonna run out. I've been waiting too long. Oh, and now I'm feeling so fine. And it just keeps getting stronger. Now I've got to make you mine. Up and down, afraid to grow old. Thank you.
I'll wait for the call.